Great. So thanks. Again, Jim Mellon, head of architecture, technology, data operations, Syngenta. Been there for 35 years, so a long time. I don't know how much you all know about Syngenta. It's the world's largest agrochemical company. We operate in some 100 countries around the world, and we are an R&D-based company, so we develop our own intellectual property. So what I want to do today, and I'm more of a storyteller than a presenter, but I want to talk about a two-year journey that we've been on. It's a continuing journey about rapidly accelerating our capabilities around decision science and decision making. So with that, a little bit of background. So this is specifically around the seeds division of our company. And the R&D function supports research from early genomic research all the way to advancement to commercialization of seed genetics, seed traits. We run over 100,000 field trials a year around the world, and that equates into millions of plots of data. And from our laboratories, we're generating, it's actually now into the billions of data points a year. So significant amount of data. We've got 200 applications that are managed by the global IT team, supporting data collection that's required to generate the analytics, especially predictive analytics that we need. We also, and this is within the last year, are very much more into streaming data. So this will be data streaming from farms. Could be drone imagery, data from harvesters, planters, things like that. All that data goes into decision making about what genetics to advance along our pipeline, but the commercialization targeted to our farmers. So where we were at the beginning of this two-year journey that I was asked to come in and leave, we had recently migrated a data capability based in Hadoop into Amazon S3, so that was in its infancy. We are managing about 5 petabytes of data, and it's made up of genomic, phenotypic, environmental, and image data is becoming much more a part of that volume as well. We have had a hybrid infrastructure, so on-premise, mostly to support the laboratories and instrument integration, and AWS, primarily AWS Virginia for the R&D capabilities. In addition to what we needed to do with data, we needed to modernize our applications, many of them monolithic in design, and really needed to move that to a more modern digital platform. So several steps we went through, I won't read them all out, but there were a couple key imperatives that we had to achieve with this journey. One was speed. We viewed ourselves as behind where we wanted to be, so acceleration was important. And data protection. So data protection, as everybody knows, is very much on the minds of people who lose sleep at night worrying about their data protection. So those are two key imperatives, speed and data protection. So where we want to go? We want to go from today's applications, and so many of these were very monolithic, these huge applications built around somebody's job or a specific process. Very hard to change them. Each one had its own web server, application server, database, so forth. Where we wanted to get to is a more modern approach with our applications, which was a layered foundation enabling and solutions layer. This was going to be a multi-year journey. We had to move from this siloed environment to a more modern, layered environment. So that foundation layer starts with data. So a couple key aspects of this that we had to manage. First is rationalization of all those siloed data sets. And where we wanted to get to was data platforms. So instead of every system having its own copy of the data, our applications are built on top of data platforms, data stored once, managed once. And from there, we needed to figure out what's the right way to store the data so we don't force everything to relational. What's the right store for the type of data? Could be relational, could be graph, could be key value pair, whatever that is, we use the right technology. We need to build up stewardship around that data. The key component there is data platform owners. In the old way we did things, the owners were pretty much aligned to applications, not to data. So that was a key component of creating these data product owners. And then access to the data, we have multiple access routes to the data. One would be applications, BI tools, things like that. But the other is for data scientists who want to do data exploration. So they want access to all the data, the raw data, the warts and all data, looking for new patterns and new innovations that they could get from that data. So if you think back to the last slide, on the left-hand side, it was today's applications. And because of these big monolithic applications, what happens is because either people have a hard time getting the data out of them, aren't allowed to get the data, a large entourage of little databases started surrounding these. So business functions, IT teams would start copying data into separate databases, and they start with spring up everywhere. It could be Excel, could be Access, smart sheets out there. What happens when we create all these extra databases? One, the data is redundant. Two, the data may have been changed in some of these systems, but not all of them. So a lot of the data quality got fixed in these external data sets, not at the source. And I think the other key thing is that scientists couldn't find their data. They didn't know where to get it because there were so many sources. So where we wanted to get to, this is the old stuff, right? We've got old stuff moving to the new type of platforms. We wanted to get rid of all those extra entourage of databases, spreadsheets, things like that. This process is going to take a long time. It's going to take multiple years. So how do we accelerate moving to the new while keeping access to the old? This is where we introduced data virtualization. We brought in Denodo, and Denodo is a logical data platform for managing data. And the key aspect that allows you to create logical data views without having to actually move data from one place to another. So once we brought in Denodo, we were able to virtualize the old stuff, the new stuff as it's built, and even ability to bring in software as a service warehouses without actually having to move the data. So some key components of this. It's much faster to get data into the platform to be shared. So all these data scientists come up with a new data set. We can quickly virtualize it, immediately start using it before we even figure out where it's going to land, whether it's going to land in the data lake, or hopefully it's going to land in one of these new data platforms that we're building. The second is, we've got a unified data access layer over the top of the data. So once the data is classified, we can protect it, we can mask it if it's sensitive data, and we can share that, and it's all centrally managed. It's not a separate security management for every source system. We can control this centrally for access to the data. Second thing is we can quickly build business views of data from multiple data sources. We don't have to make another copy of the data. We don't have to move the data. We can create logical business views that all the data scientists applications can all consume. As I mentioned, centrally managed data protection, masking, and data lineage. The consumers know where the data came from because we manage that. So some of the things that we learned requires different thinking and skill sets. First thing, when an application builds a new system, I got to make a new database. Well, no, you don't really, because that data already exists somewhere else. So a lot of things in thinking and mindset around moving to this logical, virtual data platform. It looks like to the consumers like one giant database. But what other things we learned, sometimes complex views are better done through ETL and ELT than actually a logical view. So very, very large data, billion rows joined with 10 billions of rows across multiple data sources. Sometimes it makes more sense to create a data mart and virtualize the data mart. So the things we learned along the way. One of the key things we learned, don't assume that all of your data scientists know how to write coherent SQL statements. If you can imagine data exploration, joining billions of rows of data, inadvertently creating Cartesian joins and things like that can have real impact on the system. And that was a real key learning, was that impact from the different types of data access and patterns that we saw. Sometimes, and a really important thing here is predictability of how long your query is going to run is really important. So if a data scientist generates a query that runs in 2 minutes, but tomorrow he runs it and it takes 10 minutes, next day it takes five, that's problematic. And oftentimes if it doesn't run two, they kill it and start it again. So now you got the same giant query running two, three, four times in the background, really impacting the performance for everyone. So our next step was we needed a data acceleration layer because of the performance of everything just in S3. And we brought in Redshift. Redshift really gave us the ability to quickly put a columnar engine over S3-based Parquet data. And as the next step, we found that we even needed to create some local Redshift tables to get the performance high enough. So this data acceleration became really important, but even Redshift wasn't going to be enough. And by the way, when we brought in Redshift, all we had to do is repoint the virtual connections to the new source. The consumers didn't even know it changed, other than it ran faster. The key problem is it didn't run fast enough, especially with the combination of large queries combined with critical applications. We were able then to bring in Snowflake. We switched it out, Redshift for Snowflake, in a matter of 6 weeks. One, because I have a great team, but two, the virtualization allowed us to switch it out, change the pointers to the new data source. The consumers didn't even know it changed, except it got faster. So what's next for us? Currently, we're based in two locations. Data sits primarily in Europe and North America, commercial and R&D. The journey continues to where, because of policy-based government regulations, things like that, privacy, data localization is going to be required. We have to figure out how to make this global data mesh. That's being able to access data where it sits, not all centrally. So logical data will be a key component, as well as working with AWS to figure out how to move data, mirror data, and things like that. So a lot of learnings, and I won't read all these out, but a couple key things. Don't be judgmental about the past. The easiest thing to get someone you need to work with to shut down is tell them what you did was stupid, or I wouldn't have done it that way. It's the past. People had to survive. It's all going forward. So I think that's key. Another key one is, because we're moving so fast, the business understands, they understand there'll be bumps in the road. Don't make the same bumps a second time, because they'll start to lose patience. And move as fast as possible, minimize the impact on the consumers is the important part there. So benefits, faster onboarding of new data sets, get them in there, get them shared, before you even know what you're going to do with it, let the scientists start exploring what's going on. Our user base increased from literally 4 or 5 scientists to over 350 now, and this is in the matter of the last year. So it's actually helping adoption of data-driven decision-making. And we've got over 500 business views created to date, and that number is probably a month old, so it's probably more than that. So I want to say thank you. I'll be here if anybody want to ask more questions.